I am Ria Guha from University of Calcutta, Department of Linguistics. And I am doing a PhD under the supervision of Dr. Selvin Jassy. Today I will present you a paper on unintended irony, a receiver's account of verbal irony. So, see, verbal irony is popularly known as saying the opposite of what one means. Weiss's idea of verbal irony states it as a violation of truthfulness maxim where the implicator is opposite of the literal counterpart. But researchers have shown that it does not always violate the truthfulness maxim, nor it is always the opposite. So far, there have been many theories of verbal irony, like Eco theory, Pickens theory, and others, as you can see here. But the only common thing among them is the producer's ironic intention. If it is not present, it will be counted as a situational irony and not a verbal irony. Although Gibbs has claimed even without the producer's deliberate intention, an utterance can be a verbal irony, but it has been refuted. But this paper aims to show that even an unintended irony should be considered as a verbal irony if it follows a particular criteria. Hutchins' idea of irony is the inspiration behind this paper. Situational irony is the one where the situation turns opposite of what was expected. It may be of two types, one that includes a verbal counterpart and the other which does not. Now you see, I just said good evening. If you think that I did that by mistake, then it will be a situational irony given my topic is on irony. But if you think that because of this session is running late, that's why I said it intentionally, then it will be a verbal irony for you. But if someone thinks that who does not know where I live and it's evening time here, then it will be a non-irony for that person. Now you see the process of communication, how it happens. According to Grice, communication is a two-state process where the producer tries to communicate a proposition to the receiver and she makes sure that the receiver knows for sure that she intends the receiver to recognize her intention as such. Then why do we have miscommunication? So Sparber and Wilson have said, any communication act is successful if the proposition intended by the producer matches the receiver's set of propositions when the evidence is provided to justify the hypothesis about the producer's intention. Communication is achieved when the hypothesis does not match the piece intention or the producer's intention. It is a miscommunication. When there are more than one hypothesis that match the producer's intention, the communication becomes indeterminate. Okay, so again, Weinreich has said that producer presupposes the receiver's shared knowledge. However, Kieser has shown that producers often take the private knowledge as a shared knowledge and therefore a miscommunication takes place. Plus, the receiver also takes an egocentric approach to the process of understanding rather than attempting to consider the producer's mental state. As a result, we have miscommunications. Context, that is the physical setting like time and place, the verbal context, shared knowledge between the producer and the receiver, which includes information on the producer's ideology, attitude, knowledge about each other's beliefs, the producer's occupation to some extent, whether the producer is ironic by nature, background or world knowledge, being part of the same discursive community and others help in understanding verbal irony. Also, there are irony markers employed by the producer to help the receiver to detect irony. These markers vary depending on the mode of communication. As you can see here, I have used typographical markers such as quotation marks, exclamations, and question marks as it is a written mode. We have categorized verbal irony in two ways based on evidentiality. Suppose you are outside with a friend and it's 40 degrees centigrade and she says, oh, it's freezing. You will know it's a verbal irony as the incongruence between the utterance and the context is evident. We call it evidential verbal irony. And where this incongruence is not evident and you have to rely on your knowledge, we have called it a non-evidential verbal irony. The rest of this paper mainly based on this second type. Here we have presented a few possibilities in an ironic communication based on the theories we have discussed earlier. As you can see, the phase 3 is separated by a dotted line because it is not always present in a communication, especially not in an indirect communication where the receiver is not in direct contact with the producer, like in case of books or films, or even, you know, Twitter posts comments sometimes. Number one is an ideal ironic communication where the producer intends the irony and the receiver confers it as such. This table shows non-evidential ironies. Two is considered as a misfired verbal irony where the P intends the irony but R misses it. Producer may regress it or not by saying things like "I was kidding" or "that was a sarcasm" or "that was an irony" like that. In case of 3 and 4, there is no difference in phase 2 and 3 from the receiver's perspective. Both will be taken as a verbal irony or suspected as such by her unless the producer says otherwise and she believes the producer. We will call 3 as an unintended verbal irony and 4 is called a deceptive verbal irony by Martha Daimel. Suspected is used here because of the presence of more than one hypothesis and when the receiver is indeterminate of the intention of the producer. Now, 5 is where in the phase 3 the producer neither accepts it to be ironic nor denies it, saying it's up to you or whatever you think. Next, I have proposed here a model of clash and match to explain how it becomes a verbal irony for both the producer and the receiver. You can see here, suppose R, the receiver, gave a performance and P said, "You did great." If this utterance clashes with the producer's belief, it will be an irony for her. Okay, if it matches her belief, it will be a non-irony for her, as in 2. Just like that, if the utterance clashes with the receiver's beliefs, it will be an irony for her, but if it matches, it will be a non-irony for her. Interestingly, even if it is an irony for the producer, but if it matches the receiver's belief, she may miss the irony and take it sincerely. And in 4, even if it is sincere and meant non-ironically, like a compliment, but it clashes with the receiver's beliefs, it will be taken as a verbal irony. This model does not only explain irony based on word opposition, but also those which either do not violate the truthfulness maxim, but expresses a negative attitude, like "you surely know a lot," or used by Kumo Nakamura and Glucksberg and et al., and also those which rather violate the sincerity condition, as you can see in this table, like for example, questions. When questions are used ironically, like here I have used "when aren't you great." So you can see here, if the producer is sincere but the receiver thinks he is insincere, it will be an irony for her. And if he is insincere but R thinks she is sincere, it will be a non-irony for her. While 2 is a misfired verbal irony, 1 is the unintended verbal irony. Now, an utterance, whether intended or unintended as ironic by the producer, is processed in the same way by the receiver. Only when the evidence or her knowledge makes her believe that the producer is intending irony, the utterance becomes ironic to her. After this phase, if her assumption matches the producer's intention, it becomes a successful communication of verbal irony. If it does not, we call it an unintended irony. Then how it is different from Gibbs's unintended irony? So, in case of Gibbs, the receivers know that the producer did not intend the irony. It was rather the situation which made it an ironic utterance. But in our unintended irony, the receiver believes that the producer intended the irony. It's another fact that if, in the communication, the producer later denies it. It's another fact that at a point of time, the receiver believes that the, producer intended as irony. So, our unintended verbal irony is from the receiver's perspective, whereas Gibbs's unintended verbal irony is unintended from both receiver and producer's perspective. So, to conclude, I say verbal irony always includes the producer's ironic intention. Either it is really intended by the producer or it is believed so by the receiver. When phase 1, where P intends the irony, and phase 2, where R confers the irony, converge, we have a successful ironic communication, a prototype verbal irony. If either of them is missed, we have a miscommunication. But nonetheless, they end up in being different kinds of verbal irony. If phase 2 is missed, we have a misfired verbal irony. If phase 1 is missed, we have an unintended verbal irony. So we must see unintended verbal ironies in a new light. So that's it for today. Thank you for being with me.